And I turned up, it was a black tie event, and I was there, and I walked into the champagne reception that was held by the judges first. And you walk in with all the judges, and I was their guest speaker. And basically, you have a lovely meal, and then at the end of it, when all the solicitors and all their staff are more or less pretty much drunk, you get up to talk for 20 minutes. Whoopee. But I said, I'd go and do this. So I got in this champagne reception, I stood there, and a judge turned to me, goes, oh, hello. I said, you're our speaker, aren't you? I said, yes, yeah. I understand you're a man of the cloth. And I said, So what? What is a man of religion going to tell 300 solicitors then tonight? Good question. Because I hadn't made up my mind. And I looked at him and I said, sir, I'm going to tell them about random acts of kindness. He goes, oh, I've never heard of random acts of kindness before. I said, no. He said, I've heard of random acts of violence and vandalism. I said, I'm going to stand up and I'm going to talk about surprising yourself and being kind when it's unexpected.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website, you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts. Today's program is called Love is All You Need by Evangelist Phil Collins on Greenford Baptist Church's 79th anniversary.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dave, for that warm welcome. Good morning, everybody. It's great to be a part of your 79th anniversary. And I look forward to the 80th. Not that I'm looking for an invitation, but that, if this is anything to go by, that should be a magnificent event. Of course, the celebration of Henry VIII going to the English throne is 500 years this month. But I don't know why I tell you that. It's not really anything to celebrate, is it? But it is interesting the way that we celebrate things. Let me tell you a little bit about myself and what I'm involved in. I shared a little bit when Dave interviewed me. I'm married to Michelle and have four children. Yeah, I know I don't look old enough. And I'm actually 22, and this is what it's done to me. No, I'm not, yes. I've got four children. The first two are twins, and that was a shock. We went for the 12-week scan. Now, I know the young people are staying in here, and the role of men have changed over the years, hasn't it? You know, we used to wait around for the birth of our children. Now we fully participate. Well, I never had that chance to wait around, but my father certainly did. And so you go into this little room and you look at a little TV screen and you see your unborn child and with lovely baby dedication. And you see, you go, oh. But really, you haven't got a clue what you're looking at. Because it's a black and white screen, and it looks like a weather satellite photograph, and there's a cold front coming from the north, and I'm looking at my wife going, oh, darling, oh, beautiful, beautiful. Oh, it looks just like your mum. And beautiful, beautiful. I'm looking and everything, and then the lady says, oh, you won't say that in a moment. I said, oh, why? She swung the screen around and she said, look, there's two. I said, two what? Two legs. No, two babies. And I went, ah, ah. I mean, that it was like winning the lottery. Not that I do the lottery, but it was like winning the lottery. Because suddenly, there we were. We thought, oh, great idea. We're married. Let's have a baby. I guess, and let's have two. So along came Emily and Jessica. They're 10 now. So I remember holding Jessica, and she was beautiful, and she was lovely, and I was holding her, and just born, she was 5'8" pounds. So big one. Thank you. And very good. And I was holding her, and I panicked because I've got another one. So I put Jessica down, and I picked up Emily, 6'2" pounds, and I realised that I had a God-given ability to love two children at the same time with the same intensity, just like God. And God has the ability to love you as if you're his only child at this moment, but he has got millions. And he loves you completely and utterly. So that's Emily and Jessica. And then there's Isabella. And she's Italian. And she's 6. And so all she does is smile. She just wakes up and smiles all day long. And smiles all the time. And then there's Josiah. He's obviously Jewish. And he's 2. So 2, 6, and 10. So I'm very happy to be with you for a rest, and it's wonderful. So my wife Michelle is a youth and community worker, but is about to become a full-time family pastor worker at a local church and studies theology. So there'll be 2 preachers in the family now. And I've been in ministry for, I don't know what, over 20 years now, and discovered Christ. And I just want to share my heart about mission, share my heart about evangelism. It feels wonderful to be here because you love Jesus. And I also can tell that you love the gospel, and that the gospel changes lives. And the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. That is my favorite verse. Romans chapter 1, verse 14, when Paul says, I am obligated both to Jew and non, both I am eager to preach the gospel also to you who are at Rome, because I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God unto salvation. And it is wonderful to be with you, to hear of you, what, over 100 of you going out onto the streets of the estate here, knocking on doors, talking to people, and sharing the love of God with them. That's what this nation needs. We need a generation and a people that are willing to step up and say, listen, I really love Jesus. And I want to tell people about Jesus. I'm not ashamed of Jesus. In fact, why? Because it's the power, the dynamite. It is explosive. It can cause empires to crumble because the power of the message of Jesus. And I think that has been the driving force within my life. And when you're 79 years old, you can still be like Caleb, who felt as young as a 40-year-old and ready to go and fight in the mountains. That as a church, you can be young. As a church, you can be dynamic. As a church, you can be full of evangelistic zeal because you utterly know and believe that God can make a difference. I haven't always been a Christian. My dad's an atheist, he's now an agnostic, so there's been a progression. And I was sent to an English private school to be educated. I hide it well. That's because I was expelled. And at 15 years old, having been expelled from my school and standing on a street corner smoking a Benson Hedges cigarette, drinking a tin of beer with a group of lads standing there hanging around, all of a sudden, a Christian walked up to us. And he was a Christian. He was wearing a cagoule. And as he walked towards me, he said, excuse me, do you know God loves you? Well, I told him to go away. Told him I didn't believe in God. And he argued and he chatted and he talked and it was an interesting conversation. And he said, will you come to church? I said, all right, then I'll come to church if I can bring all of my friends with me. He said, come on, more the merrier. I said, it will be merry. Sunday night came, 40 of us went to church. And I don't know, this. I had back then I had spiked hair. And I used to wear spiked shoes. And I used to have a suit in the early 80s that changed colour. That went from, it was two-tone, that went from red to green, red to green. I looked like a paralytic traffic light. And I was there and we walked into the church, into this little church, and we all sat on the balcony and people were singing, they were clapping, we were messing around, we got told off by the bouncers, I mean the deacons, and we were asked to leave. But something happened in my life and I wanted to keep coming back to that church. And on one Sunday night, in a very simple gospel presentation, I sat there and all of a sudden sensed an incredible need deep down within my life that I needed Jesus and that he changed me. And at that moment, the preacher said, if you want to give your life to Jesus, put your hand up right now. And I remember my hand flew up and I looked at my hand and I said, what are you doing? And I was getting saved. And that night, I gave my life to Jesus. And oh, it was a friendly little church. And they said, oh, come on, come to the youth fellowship. You know, I was 15 years old, went along. And there was all the young people, about 30 of them, rammed into a front room. And they were singing and laughing, enjoying themselves. They were singing a song that we don't sing anymore, but some of you might know it. Father Abraham had many sons. Let's all praise the Lord. Right arm, right leg, left leg, nod your head, turn around, punch somebody in the face. And it was just, they were singing and they were, it was great. I thought, great, I can become a Christian and I can punch somebody. So I'm walking home that evening and let me explain what I felt like. I felt clean for the first time in my life. And I felt new. Amen. And that's the power of God unto salvation. And I remember I walked home and I can't get this song out of my head. And I'm going, Father Abraham had many sons. Father Abraham had many sons. And I am one of them. How can I be one of them? My dad's called Mike. I come home. And I knock on the door, my mum throws the door open, I'm late, she tells me off, she sends me to the bedroom. I said, Mum, I've become a Christian. She says, don't be so ridiculous. Slam the door, get down on my knees, I start to pray and I fall asleep. The next morning I wake up and you know what, God is still with me. Amen. And I get ready to go to school. I know God has changed me because I'm going to school. And I start to walk down the stairs and I remember I'm on my way to school and I get into my form room and they're all my friends. And I just remember I turn around to them. I didn't know what I was doing or why I was doing it. I just said, listen, I've become a Christian. Now, this is not always the best evangelistic approach. I said, and if you want to become a Christian, come and see me. Right now. So I'm going, what am I doing? Father Abraham had many sons. And there's a tap on my shoulder and I turn around and there's this young lady stood there. Her name's Cindy. I still know her. She works in Sainsbury's. And she said to me, Phil, I want to become a Christian. She said, what do I have to do? I said, I don't know. But you can do what I did if you want and we'll see if it works. She said, all right then. I said, you've got to close your eyes, close your eyes. You've got to pray this prayer, pray this prayer. And in my back pocket the night before, they gave me a little booklet called Journey into Life. And I looked to open the back of it, and there's a prayer, and it goes, Dear Lord Jesus. She said, Dear Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner, and I'm a sinner. And I've done lots of things in my life. Get the idea. We go all the way through this prayer, and at the end of it, her eyes are still closed. And I'm thinking, what's happening? And I reached across and I poked her. I said, Cindy, what? She looks at me and she goes, Phil. I said, yes, it's true. I said, what? She said, Jesus, it's true. I said, I know, it's true. And that was the first person I ever led to Jesus. And from that moment, I knew that God had called me to be an evangelist. I knew that God had called me to win people to Christ. And if a little bit of theology here, John Stott calls this, that we stand between two worlds. We stand between the kingdom of darkness and the kingdom of light, and we have the ministry of reconciliation. We bring the two together through Jesus. Isn't that exciting? And I remember that really from that point on, all I had was a desire to share the love of God, a desire to step out, a desire to share Christ. Now, that was 1981, and the world has changed, but the message is still as powerful. It was 1981, and all the bands of that era are now reforming. A little bit heavier than they were originally, but they're reforming. And the one thing I know is that throughout that whole time that Jesus Christ has worked and has changed. And I remember, I could tell you story after story, but about how the gospel impacts lives. And that's really what I want to do. So if I'm sharing this morning, it's because I have experienced this wonderful salvation that you go out and you share. And on your 79th birthday, remember what it's all about. Because it's about Jesus. It's about the difference that he makes. So let's start for a moment in 1 Peter chapter 3. And what I want to talk about is being a distinctive in our lifestyle and standing out. And you know, the question is, where would a person go to if they were spiritually seeking? And the sad reality that in the British Isles, often the church is the last place where people go for spiritual help. Now, of course, what God is doing here is amazing. But very often people view the church in a negative, boring and uninteresting way. And yet, we have the greatest message that changes lives. And in 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 13, it says, Who is going to harm you if you are eager to do good? But even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear. Do not be frightened. But in your heart, set apart Christ as Lord. Always be prepared. This is the favorite verse for evangelists. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give a reason for hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect. Now, we evangelists are always looking at this verse and going, come on, always be ready to give an answer. Go on, give the answer. But to give an answer, you have to have created a question. And this verse is in the context of a question that we create as believers. And Peter here is talking about and encouraging the believers that we have to live distinctive life that shows a difference, that we are not just, you know, nice people, but there is something remarkably different about who we are. And he says, do not be like them who, you know, are afraid. What is the context of this verse? Well, very simply, what were they afraid of? What is he talking about? He's talking about in this context, at this time, people are utterly afraid of death. Because the Roman Empire, the worship of Caesar, gave them no comfort when it came to death and eternity. And people were terrified of eternity. They were terrified of death because the deities and the gods of the Roman Empire and Caesar himself gave them no hope and salvation. And he says, listen, don't be afraid like them. But step out and stand up. Why? Because you are different. And when people ask you, why are you different? Why do you believe differently? Then be ready to give an answer. Be ready to share your faith in a respectful, gentle way. But you are called to be different. And we live in an age of fear. We live in an age of anxiety. We live in an age where there is darkness. We are living in an age of unemployment, sadly, an age of the credit crunch, an age of global warming, an age of terror and fear within our world like never before in some respects. But what the scripture teaches us as church in this world is that we have to be ready to give an answer to why we are not afraid. Be ready to give an answer to share our experience in a gentle, yes, in a respectful way, yes, but we are ready because we are distinctive and we are different as a group of people. And I love this thought. I am different. I was queuing up for a coffee in Costa Coffee. And my brother-in-law brought me a Russian tracksuit. It must have been like the Russian national team. It was bright red with USSR across. And it was horrible. But I decided this day to wear it, and I zipped it up, and it had white here, so it was red, it was white, it went all the way up there, and I'd, at that point, quite long hair, and I'm standing in line for the coffee, and as I'm standing there, the man turns to me, and I say, can I have a cappuccino, please? And he looks at me, he goes, man in red, man of anger. And I went, no, man of peace. He said, how do you know that you're a man of peace? I said, because I've met the Prince of Peace. Then he looked at me, and all I want is a cappuccino. And he looked at me and he goes, I once met the Prince of Peace 15 years ago in Blackpool. I said, oh. He said, but I lost him when my marriage fell to pieces. He said, I haven't been in a church for 15 years, man of peace. I said, I think you need to sit down with me and that we need to have a chat. I remember we sat down in Costa Coffee, and as we sat down and we started to chat, he gave his life back to Jesus. But you know, it made me think and reflect on this verse that actually I am called to respond, to be distinctive, to share, because there is people out there that are looking for something different. There are people out there that are looking for, yes, we are normal people. We don't turn into a kind of Robocop when we share Jesus and pull out our evangelical submachine guns and, you know, say, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Bang! And walk away. Oh, aren't I good? No, you're not good. You just bash somebody. But actually, we're called to win people. We're called by our life to provoke people. We're called to be distinctive. We're called to be remarkable. We're called to turn heads. And people go, why are you so different? I'm different because I've got Jesus. I'm different because I'm part of a living, glorious community called the church. I'm different. Love it. So how are you to be different? on your anniversary. Well, turn with me to the book of Ephesians for a moment. And I want to talk to you about how we are called to be distinctive. And I want to talk about three areas where I believe that we can be different and we can be distinctive in our walk with God. Are you all right? You with me? You lovely people, smiling. So nice to be in London. I'm coming to London next week as well to run the London Marathon. Yeah. There's another one running. Oh, yeah, of course you are. Yeah, we talked about that, didn't we? Yeah, I think you might beat my time. I'm just hoping to do it in under 10 hours. yours 11. Ephesians chapter 4. Probably most of you know a lot about Ephesians. Ephesus was a massive Roman city, incredible amount of pressure on Christianity in this city. And yet Paul encourages in the same vein that the Christians there would be distinctive. They are in a battle, and there's a great verse about spiritual warfare, about battle, about the armor of God. But I want to just talk for a moment. If you look at verse 17, living as children of light, he says, so I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Well, I want to say, first of all, from this verse, is that he makes this statement about that you must no longer live like the Gentiles do. If you live like the rest of the world, then how can we be distinctive? If you handle your finance like the rest of the world, how can you be distinctive? If you are inhospitable like areas of the world, then how can you be distinctive? If you are not generous, not giving, not loving, not caring, not gracious, not forgiving, then how can you be distinctive? And Paul is talking, and he's starting to build up steam here in Ephesians. And he's talking, he's saying, listen, you want to be distinctive. We're in a battle. We're here as a small church in the middle of a mighty Roman city. And there are pressures on us, immense pressures. But we can live differently. We can stand out. We can shine like stars. We can be different because God has called us to be like that. So he says, you can't be like them. Now, how then? How? What areas of my life can I make sure are different to the rest of the world? Well, number one, he makes this statement. We'll just move down to verse 25. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body. So we're talking about the church and the body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry. This is the first area I think Paul is highlighting where we can turn heads, where people can notice us and where we can be distinctive. And my encouragement to you is that you seem to be doing a wonderful job at this. And this area is the way you build community and the kind of church you build. The way that the church can be distinctive in the world is the kind of communities we build, is that within this church, within the people here, with the many, many nations and who you are, actually, you demonstrate something that was demonstrated on the day of Pentecost when all the languages of the world were spoken from the east to the west, is that in Christ there is no boundaries. There are no barriers. In fact, in Christ, we are such a radical, loving, caring community that we love each other. And when people come into this church and come into the church of God, they see an authentic, caring, loving, forgiving community. And that's a distinctive in the world. because I've been in many different areas and worked in many different organizations, and I see that there is often resentment, there is often anger, there is often frustration, there is often negative activities that are going on. You don't have to listen to the news at the moment to talk about the dirty tricks in politics at this precise moment to know the kind of thing that can take place. But the church is not like this. It's a safe place. It's a loving place. It's so distinctive. When people walk through the doors of this building and they meet you, the body, you're a people that are not angry, but you're a people that forgive quickly. And you love each other. You give each other the benefit of the doubt. And you don't allow yourself to be carried away with negativity. And I know we quote this scripture in the context of marriage. You know, if you're married and you're having an argument, don't go to sleep without getting it right. But it's actually here in the context of the body that you honour each other, that you love each other. And I know church life can be difficult sometimes. I mean, I've been an elder for nearly 20 years. I've been a key leader in a church and led as a senior minister for 8 years. And I know that sometimes it's difficult. I'd sit in my office and I know this would never happen here. Pastor Dave Wise is so magnificent. But people would come into my office and you know, I could tell they were worked up. And they'd stand there and they were going to say something, and it was like suddenly they would explode. I was like, where does that come from? And in my mind, I'm thinking sinful thoughts. Like, shut up. And all I want to do is headbutt you. And there's this, do you know? And I went away for a day, and I loved to pray, and I was a day away praying with God. And I said, God, what is my response? How am I to be? Because this is stressing me out. And the Lord whispered a response to me that is so simple and yet so profound. He said, always have your response prepared. I said, what do you mean, always have it prepared? He says, whatever walks through that door, you've got your response prepared. What do you mean? Your response is love. And when you respond in love, you are being distinctive. When you respond in God's grace and God's love, boy, at that moment, you're making a difference. So if we're going to be distinctive in the world that we live in, it has to be born out of the authentic, strong, loving, supporting, remarkable community that you are as a growing church. The second area he highlights, and I know that often we can get bogged down in the teaching here, but I just want to go with the amazing ideas that are here, is in family life. Because actually, I really do believe that when Paul writes about wives and husbands and about conduct, and he writes about husbands loving their wives like Christ loved the church, here in verse 22 and right the way down, and husbands, love your wife just as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her to make her holy. You know, I think what God is actually, one of the key things that God is saying is here, we have to be distinctive in the way we do church, and we've got to be distinctive in the way we build family. The love that we show to each other, the honesty that we portray, the hospitality that are in our homes, the way that we pray together, the way that we support together, the way that we love together. Because this is what it's preached a lot about. Whenever you switch on the TV or listen to anything on God Channel, anything like this, you know, people go on about the breakdown of the family and all of that. And yet what I believe Paul is saying is we are different from the Gentiles. We are distinctive in our community, and we're also distinctive in the way that we build family and the way we conduct ourselves. And that's a pressure on the men here, because God calls you not to be like the Gentiles, not to conform to worldly ways, but to love and to give and to sacrifice as Christ loved the church. And that should turn some heads. Because your family. Now I know family, it's a broad term. It's a broad term scripturally. It's about wider family. It's about others being included. And over the years, we've had people live with us, and we've had helped people, and leading a church full of families, yes, and full of people who are single at the moment or divorced and are looking for the next step in their life. But God welcomes. But the family and the way you build your life, it means you live differently. And I really want to encourage you to be honest in your home and to really consider the distinctiveness of your lifestyle, not only to win your children to Christ, but to win your neighbours and to win your life around you. Our hairdresser surprised us recently. We have a hairdresser. Yeah, I don't use her very much. But we have a hairdresser, and she's lovely. Her name's Paula. She's been a hairdresser for years. And she said something recently that really surprised us, and she was joking about it. But it was, in one sense, it was a real compliment. Because she said, you know what? She said, I said to my husband, Marcus, the other day, she said, Marcus, why don't we just sell our house with the credit crunch and just bank the money? And Marcus goes, she said to us, Marcus said, well, what would you mean? Where are we going to live? She said, oh, we'll live with Phil and Michelle Collins. Now, they're not Christians. She said, they are so nice that if we go up to their door, bang on their door with our kids and go, we've got nowhere to live, can we move in? They'll go, yes. So she's cutting my hair and she's saying this. I'm going, oh, yeah. That's right, my hairdresser and her husband and her three kids are going to move in. I said, what? Why did you think you could just move into my house? She said, because you're just so nice and different. And she said, you're Christians, aren't you? I said, yeah, to a point. But I said, Paula, you'd be welcome, but I would never pay for a haircut again. The point I'm trying to make is this, is that there is something we build in our homes that has to be Christ-like. And the challenge is that we care and we love in our homes and live distinctive lives. I remember reading a book by a guy called John Drain, and he just happened to throw away a comment that I thought was fascinating. He said that if every Christian couple took seriously winning their children to Christ, then we would not have a decline in the British church. Wow! And I'm utterly committed to winning my children to Christ. I'm utterly committed to getting them into camp. I'm utterly committed to taking them not just to the Costa del Sol for our summer holiday or to the Greek island, but I'm committed to taking them to an environment where they can be discipled, to an environment where they make other friends, to an environment so that I can keep winning my children to God, to conducting myself in the right way, to praying with them, to loving them, to talking to them, to spending time to them, because I know it's a battle and I've got to pray every week and fast every week, but I want to believe that I can win my children to Christ, win my neighbourhood, and win my hairdresser to Jesus. Amen. Perhaps not moving in. But you can be distinctive, can't you? What about the school gate? It's hard, isn't it? It's hard for me as a kind of pastor person who loves to greet people. I don't know what to do at the school gate, because I kind of turn up then go, hi, how are you? Hi, hi, and I'm walking along and, you know, I'm viewed with a little bit of suspicion. Who is he? But I've been chipping away at this for about 5 years. And I made a lot of good friends. One day, one of my good friends at the school gate, a friend of Michelle and I, a lady called Sam, she said, what are you reading? I said, it's funny you should say that. I'm reading a really fascinating book called The Shack. And it talks about this and talks about that. And she said, oh. I said, I'd like to read it. I went, all right, then I'll give you a copy. Gave her a copy. 2 days later, my wife was at the school gate. She came up to her, burst into tears, threw her arms around her and hugged her and just said, thank you so much for giving me that book. All I want to be is to get to know and be close to Jesus. Wow. She said, you know what? I've bought 5 copies and I've given it to all the other ladies at the school gate. So they all read it and then they gathered round. They said, we want to have a meeting at your house to discuss the book and you can tell us all about Jesus. Can we come to your house? Yes. I've been trying to grow cell groups for years and suddenly this happens. But you've got to build relationships, haven't you? You've got to enjoy life. You've got to love people. You've got to be willing to share life. You've got to be willing to eat with people. You've got to be willing to love people. You've got to be willing to allow your family, you and who you are, your situation, wherever you are, to live in God. And if you're single or in a different circumstance at the moment, God has created magnificent opportunities for you at this season of your life to live a distinctive lifestyle. Let's move for a moment. I'm watching the time. But it simply goes on to talk about another area of our life. Slaves and masters. Work. Talks about slaves, verse 5 of chapter 6. Slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear, with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Obey them not only to win their favor when their eyes are on you, but like slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart. Serve wholeheartedly, as if you were serving the Lord, not men, because you know that the Lord will reward everyone for whatever good he does, whether he is a slave or free. Of course, Paul's not condoning slavery here. What we're saying is, in the context of where you work as if it's unto the Lord and be distinctive and be different. If you manage people, the way you manage people can be so remarkable that you can bring the kingdom of God. If you work for somebody, the way that you work for them, you can shine and be different. Even under the most difficult circumstances, you can live a distinctive life that turns heads. You can live a life that makes a difference. You can live a life that stands out. Why? Because everything we do, whether we do it in church community, whether we do it in our family, or whether we do it at work, we do it for Jesus Christ. We live differently, we speak differently, we act differently, so that in 1 Peter they say, why are you so different? And when people are provoked to question, we can give an answer in the most respectful, gentle, direct, magnificent way. Because in every area of our life, Jesus is at work. He's at work in our workplace, in our family, in our church community. We are not like those. We are different. I love this, to challenge in my life. And some of the hardest place we have to be different is with our family, isn't it? Our relatives. Oh, who of you got a difficult relative? Yeah, amen. You know, or somebody you've never connected with. And I think that we have to be people who are utterly generous with our love and our grace and our forgiveness. You know, I've got an older uncle and aunt who I've never really connected with. And she's battling cancer. And this really tested me, and I went away and I just started to pray. Because I want to win her to Christ. He's not in faith. He's part of the Masons. I said that recently. I went, Masons. And everybody thought I'd gone Morrison's. Yeah, he's part of that terrible supermarket, Morrison's. And it's just, normal life. We've all got people like that in our family. The difference is that I was so challenged and I hadn't spoken to them for so long that I picked up the phone and I called. And that was a hard call to make. Because I could tell you stories about winning, last Sunday I preached and three people gave their life to Christ. Two Sundays before that I preached to 2,000 young people at the Ealing Pentecostal Conference, of which, 500 responded. Praise God. But that's not the world I live in all the time. I live in normal world. I live in your world. My world. Costa Coffee. School gate. Relatives I haven't spoken to for so long. And I picked up the phone. I said, listen, I was really sorry. It was a difficult conversation, one says, because it felt a bit. But I just said, I just want to assure you of my love and my prayers at this time. That's good, isn't it? That's polite. No, what is really good and distinctive is that 12 months later, I've called every 2 weeks to check how things are. Now, that starts to go beyond. Because Jesus said, if somebody needs a coat, give it them. Jesus said, if somebody asks you to go a mile, go 2 miles. Jesus said, we are different. And of course, the normal things, send flowers, keep in touch, and they were going to renew their vows. And I knew I was breaking through because they invited me round. And then when they're going to renew their vows, they wanted me to take part in the ceremony. And if I was like we were so separated, because I suppose did something that was completely normal, and yet sometimes we forget what it is to be normally Christian, in utter love, utter giving, utter service, sacrificial, going the extra, being kind. Kind, because it's better to be kind than to be right. And we can wear ourselves out being right all the time. I'll finish on this. I went to speak at the Stoke-on-Trent annual ball, Law Society ball. So 300 lawyers and solicitors and judges. They invited me as their guest speaker. I mean, it was hilarious. And I turned up, it was a black tie event, and I was there, and I walked into the champagne reception that was held by the judges first. And you walk in with all the judges, and I was their guest speaker. And basically, you have a lovely meal, and then at the end of it, when all the solicitors and all their staff are more or less pretty much drunk, you get up to talk for 20 minutes. Whoopee. But I said, I'll go and do this. So I got in this champagne reception. I stood there and a judge turned to me and goes, oh, hello. He said, you're our speaker, aren't you? I said, yes, yeah. I understand you're a man of the cloth. And I said, well, mm-hmm. So what? What is a man of religion going to tell 300 solicitors then tonight? Good question. Because I hadn't made up my mind. And I looked at him and I said, sir, I'm going to tell them about random acts of kindness. He goes, oh, I've never heard of random acts of kindness before. I said, no. He said, I've heard of random acts of violence and vandalism. I said, I'm going to stand up and I'm going to talk about surprising yourself and being kind when it's unexpected. And that evening I got up and I did speak and it went in wonderfully. And at the end, the head of the Birmingham Law Society turned to me and said, you know, my life is utterly in a mess. My wife's left me. I'm drinking too much. And he said, I need something. What makes you so different in the way that you speak? How can I discover how to become a kind person and start to give again and start to love again and start to share again? And I just think that you, as a church, that as you go into the world, what a wonderful thing it is to go with the love of God, to go with kindness, to go with generosity, to go with the gospel, which is the power of God unto salvation. Amen? Amen. It's beautiful, isn't it? What God can do, the way God can work. Let's pray together. Right where you are, you just want God to just re-energize you in his faith and power and fill you with that love again. Then right where you are, why don't you just reach out your hands to God? And I'd love to pray. Remember what I said, he has the ability to love you as if you're his only child. And Lord, I pray right now for every member of this congregation and thank you for them, Lord. And Lord, I pray that you will come to them and that you will cause them to live a head-turning lifestyle. Lord, whether they're in the form room at school or university or college, Lord, whether they're in family, work, wherever they are, Lord, I pray that we will carry the glorious presence of Jesus, that we will choose to speak differently and be different, that we will know your power and your presence flooding through us, Lord Jesus, we ask. Amen. Amen. Amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034. And our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.